summer evening in 1717, King George I was carried on a sedan chair from St. James Palace to the banks of the Thames. There he boarded a magnificent barge and floated down the river from Whitehall to Chelsea. As they drifted, the king and his guests were entertained by an orchestra playing the finest ceremonial music ever heard. It was written for the occasion by the greatest composer of his age, George Friedrich Handel. And it was a piece that, once heard, captivated the popular imagination. The water music. The water music was only performed once, as Handel had intended it, with musicians on a barge. It was an event on a scale never attempted before and never imitated since. Until now. We have chosen a team of musicians, historians, and designers, from the characters who inhabited Handel's world to the tides of the river, from the musical fashions of the period to the true sounds of 18th century London. Our experts will build a picture of that historic moment. Together, they will recreate a uniquely grand event in London's history. The river journey from Whitehall ended with a sumptuous banquet here in the grounds of the Royal Hospital Chelsea, where the stately home of Ranelagh House once stood. It's immediately clear from this painting just how different the river was and how much the landscape of the city has since changed. Our challenge will be to retrieve a lost moment in time, to bring the 18th century to contemporary London. We'll be staging an event that brings together all the music and the spectacle, all the pageantry and excess that London saw on the 17th of July, 1717. For our team of experts, there are individual challenges to be faced, not least for the orchestra.
We're going to be on a boat. This is a new experience for us all. We're going to be wearing 18th century clothes, which is going to affect physically how we play a lot. I have to work out what is the water music, where is it? I've got to sort of dig around. Has Handel's copy survived?
I'm going to be interested in how the musicians will actually be able to hear each other outdoors.
Mm, yeah.
And also I'm going to be interested in the power of these early instruments, the sound power. The second thing I'll be interested in is how that sound will then transmit in the open air as opposed to in a concert hall.
One of the biggest hurdles will be finding an authentic boat on which the orchestra can play.
The boat's going to be a very difficult thing to find because in them days they would have been very, very elegant. Lots of highly coloured paintwork, gold paintwork, gold leaf everywhere. Long, lovely, sweeping bows with figureheads and things like that.
He painted a great picture to begin with of what it is we could do with finding, and we will hopefully find something that gives us a colour palette, really, that we'd expect would have been predominant on the barge.
I'm fascinated by the cultural context. Who commissioned this great occasion? What are the sources for it? Can we find anything that hasn't already been scoured through that tells us who was there? Why was it set up? Because it must have cost a lot of money, this whole occasion. So the political context intrigues me very much too.
How is this related to the political crisis of the year? That's my problem. And my problem really focuses on what you can make of the evidence, because there aren't diaries of people saying this is why we're going to do it, so that the sources are just really not necessarily going to answer all these questions for us.
With the challenges outlined for each of our experts, they can now set about the task of recreating the first water music performance. The most urgent task lies with Ken Dwan, bargemaster to the Queen. He's used to setting up royal events on the Thames, but finding an original 18th century barge is a different matter.
I think probably a lot of the older ones probably ended up their days sitting on the beach at Lambeth and gradually rotted away until they no longer survived. It would have been very similar to this sort of a barge here. And the oarsmen all in the front, the accommodation would have been from the midships going aft with an open top deck. Probably would have held about 100 people. But I can't imagine that they would have had people on the barge and the orchestra. I think the orchestra would have actually been on a barge of its own. I would have thought that the main event would have been the music on the top with all the flags flying. As you see in that sort of a picture, there wouldn't have been anyone allowed to go in front of that royal barge. And most of the other boats, they're all forming up in formation. It must have been quite an amazing sight. London, bear in mind, was all little cobble streets. You didn't have the wide avenues that you can actually do a very ceremonial sort of event. So the river was a natural wide highway that you could fill up with all different sorts of vessels. And everybody can actually get there to see the splendour and the importance of everybody.
You could imagine the word whizzing down the river that the king was going out on the water. You could imagine all the water community, all the watermen gossiping with each other. It's a terrific business opportunity for them. It's a tremendous compliment, too, that the king is out in their place of work doing something very special. And so I would imagine that both banks would have been lined with people. And of course, there was this flotilla of boats that followed, probably not hearing very much of the music, but feeling they were part of the occasion anyway. As we stand now, we can see, I think, seven bridges, and of course there are more stretching round up to Kingston Bridge. In 1717, no bridge at all, apart from London Bridge, down in the city. London was about 600,000 people, but crammed together. What you must imagine is a much smaller city. Westminster, towards the House of Parliament, burnt down in the 1830s and rebuilt, so none of what we can see on that site from here would have been visible in the King's time. All that we see, all the way up to Kensington, effectively, was open ground. The river was a perfect place to do something of this kind, to be seen, to be heard, to be sharing with your people. Those were the attributes, and he achieved it.
With only 3 weeks to go before restaging the water music, Ken has finally had an encouraging lead in his search for a suitable barge for the orchestra to play on.
You've got something of my interest, as I hear.
Well, I think so. I think so. She's certainly different. I mean, it's a special job, so it deserves a special boat.
Oh, she looks all right, doesn't she?
The Balliol College Oxford barge.
I
think she'll fit the bill.
Well, I did say that you're not going to get exactly what you want, but it's about the best we've seen so far. It's going to obviously want a bit of a paint up to get it more in line with the period. I like this end of the barge. It would have been nice to have had the bit on the front of the oarsman, because then you would have had something nearly as matching as you would have wanted. Because there's not much we can do with the handrails, really, is there?
If you've got a 40-piece orchestra up here, we'll have to involve the authorities, the Maritime and Coast Guard Agency and Coast Guard and the usual things, because we're operating at night with a lot of people on board.
A lot of people on it, yeah. Visually, from up here, you could imagine you was on a state barge anyway, couldn't you?
Yeah. How are we going to move it? I mean, obviously, it's a dumb barge, no engines, no steering.
No steering, yeah. Well, I was hoping it was your tugs that were going to do it, but it looks like it might be my tugs that's going to do it. So what we'd probably have to do, we'll have a tug each end.
Right.
Put the big tug on the front and the other one head to stern of this one.
Right.
To be able to steer him in and out the bridge holes and the locks.
Now there's a boat to play on, our next concern is what will be heard of the orchestra out on the river. The English concert specialises in playing the Baroque instruments of Handel's day, which generate a very different sound to their modern counterparts. Our acoustic expert, Simon Kahn, has come to meet some of the orchestra at Handel's London home to hear how 18th century sounds compared to those of the 21st.
This is an oboe nowadays. Look at all that metal.
This lovely metal helps you to play most intricate music beautifully, but it won't make that much difference to the sound.
The keys, they do make a difference to the sound, because with the early oboes, you're using your fingers to do a lot of the chromatic notes, where you would use a key on the modern oboe. Right. So that makes a very different sound.
Ah. sounds louder to me.
To me, it does.
Yeah.
This is a natural trumpet in D, about 7.5 feet of tubing. And this is a modern trumpet in D.
Yeah.
And it's exactly half the length of tubing.
Playing on a boat is very unusual for us. We do most of our concerts either in concert halls or, even better, churches. The instruments sound great in churches because there's an acoustic to pick up the sound and to take it around the buildings as it reaches the ears in this nice round fashion. Now, outdoors, if you like, there's no acoustic. And not only is there no acoustic, but there's surrounding noise as well. If the wind blows, you know, that's going to make a noise for the ears of the listener and the players.
The weaker of the two blows.
Later in the 18th century, we're not quite sure, this kind of very short, steeply arched bow came into use. Again, held from the side.
Yeah.
So which one would Handel have expected you to use on his boat?
I imagine one of these two held from the side.
Yeah.
And, it was customary in pits or anywhere there was a space problem to use a shorter boat. And if it's crowded on the boat, I'm going to use this. If I've got enough room, I'll use this.
If we look at the...
We think that this was perhaps the first time Handel used the horn as an instrument in, if you like, serious music. The horn was something you blew when you wanted to call the dogs for a hunt or something. It was a functional instrument for outdoors. But Handel, of course, saw the potential. If you're on the river, you need instruments with carry.
When you're playing the horn, I can actually hear an echo off the walls. Mm. Now, of course, outside, we're not going to have that unless there are big buildings alongside. And on the banks of the Thames in Handel's day, I don't think there'd be many big buildings except in the centre of London.
The water music is... it's a great pleasure to play. I think that music, more than almost any other in the Baroque era, it's so well written for the instruments. It gives you fun things to do, some difficult things, but not too difficult. Handel knows that if he gives you things that are very difficult, it might not sound so good on the day, so he's clever in that way.
Handel was born in 1685 and developed his skills in his native Germany before taking a grand tour around Europe. Having mastered fashionable French dance music, he spent 4 influential years in Italy, honing his talents before returning to his homeland to compose for George, the ruler of Hanover. By the time he arrived in London in 1710, he was the most famous composer of his day. And it was here that he wrote some of his greatest work, from fireworks music to Messiah.
I think we've actually done a rather English thing. We've taken Handel and said, that is English. The English loved the music so much that they adopted Handel. The funny thing is, he spoke English, but not terribly well, and he had a very strong German accent, but never mind. We decided he wasn't only English. The music he wrote was the English style, and from then on, English music, you could say, was Handelian for decades.
But the English knack of taking the foreign and making it our own wasn't just confined to composers. When Queen Anne died in 1714, leaving no heir, the government turned to Germany to find its new monarch. George, ruler of Hanover, may have been 58th in line to the throne, but he was a Protestant, which was more than could be said of Anne's Catholic relations. King George sailed into Greenwich in spectacular fashion, hoping for a warm welcome from his new people.
So George I comes here in 1714, and he comes to a rather troubled inheritance. There are many people who do not actually want him to be king. There are people who believe that the exiled Stuarts should be king, and in fact, in 1715, there is a big rising against him on behalf of the man who calls himself James III. That gets defeated. But after that, in 1716, the government started itself to divide. The Whig government splits badly over George's policies. George essentially tries to use British resources to pursue the interests of his native Hanover, and that was the background to the political crisis that gathered steam in 1717. To add fuel to the fire, there was a serious crisis in the royal family. Now, as we know, in all monarchical situations, there is always a tension between the ruler and their heir. Has to be, because the heir is not going to come into their own until the ruler either dies, as is usually the case, or abdicates. This feeds into a social rivalry between the two. They each have, in effect, a royal court. They're each concerned to create the impression of majestas, that they are the person who is the pinnacle of style. Now, the person who's under the most pressure is the father, George I. By the standards of the age, he, in fact, is getting to be an old man, and the future appears to rest with his son.
Philippa is doing some detective work to see if she can find any first-hand accounts of the dramatic events of the summer of 1717.
As a team, we're going to be bringing together pieces in a jigsaw puzzle. We're not even quite sure what the total shape is yet, but if there's anywhere in London that we could find much and something unknown, it's the Society of Antiquaries, because it is the most wonderful compilation of drawings, engravings, obscure facts. And I think that we should be able to find something, even if it's only background material, to help us understand London, to help us think a bit harder about what it was like to be the king in St. James's Palace, fighting for space with his son, both of them trying to entertain, both of them rivaling each other. They're competing. The Prince of Wales is happy to have evening entertainments, drawing rooms. The king doesn't want to attend them. The king refuses to dine in public, which was expected of a monarch. The Prince of Wales is happy to dine in public. Essentially, kingship is about image. And George had to improve his.
The government needs to think about a kind of what we would call an image makeover. And they do that quite successfully in some respects. They get him to host a lot of parties at Hampton Court. A lot of the elite go to them. The king glad hands them, takes part in polite conversation, is seen. But to be seen, you have to be seen by more people than the elite at Hampton Court. And the government also thinks about a kind of public celebration, a public gesture. And a courtier has an idea. Man's name is Count Kilmansegg. He's a Hanoverian. He had an idea as to how best to associate George with a public display of glory, of culture, of art, and of artifice that would make the king look popular and would in many senses create a glorious golden glow for the summer.
These are tiny scraps of evidence from which to build the context for this extraordinary event. London, the 19th of July. This is the Daily Courant, which is one of the newspapers. On Wednesday evening at about 8, the king took water at Whitehall in an open barge, wherein were also the Duchess of Bolton, the Duchess of Newcastle, Countess of Godolphin, Madame Kilmansegg, and the Earl of Orkney. Many other barges with persons of quality, so great a number of boats, the whole river in a manner was covered, city company barge for the music, which is played all the way from Lambeth, the finest symphonies composed express for this occasion by Mr. Handel, which his Majesty liked so well that he caused it to be played over 3 times in going and returning. At 11, His Majesty went ashore at Chelsea, where a supper was prepared. Then there was another very fine concert of music, which lasted till 2, after which His Majesty came again into his barge and returned the same way, the music continuing to play until he landed. That's very significant. That's clearly issued by, as it were, a press agent 2 days later. So we have that evidence. And then there's a wonderful letter from a German diplomat in London, Monsieur Bonnier, and he describes it quite vividly, and he makes it clear that the key figure in this whole royal event is Baron Kilmansegg. very significant person. He was the person who made it happen for the king. Why would Kilmansegg make this big investment? It was a big investment, £150. To put out this amount of money for a single evening was an enormous payment. He's helping the king to appear more acceptable to his English subjects. He's creating an occasion by which the court would be judged as noble and gracious. And of course, he's pleasing his friend, George I. But the last line of the report, in a way, is the most important. Neither the prince nor the princess took any part in this fete. In other words, there was a snub, very public snub, which pipped the Prince of Wales, because he now couldn't do a big water party to compete with his father, as he had been doing.
That's good. Could the trumpet and horn swap positions?
Our acoustic expert, Simon, has taken some members of the orchestra out on the Thames to a spot which he thinks may sound similar to the river in 1717. He's conducting some tests to find out what George I might have heard of the water music and what we are likely to hear in our recreation.
Lovely, and the same for the horn.
And what we've discovered today with our experiments is that the horn does carry better in all directions. It sounds very different, though, depending on which way the bell's facing. And we get some very interesting effects if there are any reflections, even a reflection off a tree or off another boat or a boatyard or a small building.
And the other way round.
Handel must have known that he could get this very dramatic effect. I think in some of the writing, you hear he writes for the trumpets and then the horns echo this. And I think in the acoustic environment of Out of Doors, that would have been emphasised with this echo effect. I'm fairly confident that the king would have heard the violins. Whether he'd have heard the basses and the full orchestral sound, I'm not so sure.
I'm pointing away. And finally, the double bass, please.
Having done the tests, I'm fairly confident now that on the day in 1717 and today in the 21st century, we can reproduce this event and we can get a reasonable approximation of what we would have heard on the river. And I think somebody on the river, up to 20 feet away from the musicians, would have heard a good approximation of the music.
There's a sense of relief among the team to know that the music will be heard on the river. But Ian, our designer, still has to make sure his transformation of the barge is fit for a royal spectacular.
It's never going to be seen in very, very close detail.
What it is at the moment is you've got a small piece and your eyes go into that little piece. By the time you've done the whole length, it'll look fine. Thing has to be right, but almost understated, because it isn't the star. If it's wrong, then it stands out. If it's correct, then it's background. Because, I mean, this really is a vehicle for the orchestra to perform on. What do you think?
Yeah, it's definitely changed.
I have to be honest, when I first saw the barge, I hadn't got a clue what it was we were going to do. I mean, I've been supplied with lots of very useful research and information, which helped greatly. And I did find that when I actually saw it in a smaller scale and on a drawing board, it actually started to break itself down, that the back end was obviously of a different type of construction and could be treated differently. That as you came along, the colours almost defined themselves because you got such a regimented pattern. I still put my hand up that I hate the windows. I don't mind seeing some of it, but I just would love if we could try and hide this top part of the sash windows.
The the barge isn't the only thing undergoing a makeover for the performance.
My goodness.
This is fantastic.
Now, this is going to be interesting to feel how it is to play a violin with this cravat on.
If you hold on to the ends of your sleeves.
Because they're very full,
they
aren't
are they? Full, yeah.
My sleeves are stuck, actually.
It's a bit too tight. It's going to be quite uncomfortable to play.
That's fine, so long as it's not in the way of the fingers.
Would there have been any women that worked in orchestras?
Not working in orchestras. There were lots of women musicians. I mean, people took lessons and played instruments, yes. But not anything as grubby as being a professional musician.
Oh, really?
You know, No, it was a man's profession.
That's OK, actually, yeah.
The wig looks great as well.
Oh, you cheeky.
What we're doing at the back end of the boat.
Oh, yes.
I didn't know what to do strictly, so got hold of Jeremy, the scenic artist, and we've looked through original references of nautical things, and this is a scene that we've come up with. I don't know what you think.
You know, I think it's great. I mean, you can't go wrong, obviously, with the dolphins and the cherubs and the things like that. If you look at most of the city livery companies,
right.
It predominantly is dolphins. So, and I think it would have been in character with what would have been about at that time. But it looks great. It's...
We'll leave him to finish his dolphin scales, long.
Yes. Right. Do you do bedrooms?
I was worried about this. I thought it was going to be coming down here, but this is fine because I'm going to have a violin there, of course. I'll get
I mean, we could have it longer because it's ladders that they pin on.
This did they add it on in a, on this... a whim? Like, today I'll have an extra big wig?
Or... I think so, yeah. And they just got bigger and bigger.
Yeah.
I've been longing for a wig for years. My wife won't let me have one.
Now, how attached are you to your beard?
I've had this beard for a very long time. But...
I know, they just didn't have any facial at all in this period.
I see.
But are you fine to do that?
Yeah, anything you say.
If a musician really gets going, you know, a quick movement of the head and the wig's off. If I just, you know, flick it sideways and get...
Does it have to be grey?
Most of the time I'll be looking to my left, but there might be some times when I'm looking to my left. I was worried the wig, I'd get all tangled up with my bow stuck.
Oh, it'd be pinned on as well.
Cool. Yeah, sorry about that.
Thanks, Damon.
The bits that go...
That sort of thing.
Oh, no, I'm worried about that, yes.
Yeah,
do you know what I mean?
Does it feel tight?
No, it doesn't feel particularly tight, actually.
It won't come off.
No,
well, it will eventually.
Even if I were to do a very, very spontaneous, wild gesture.
It'll be fine, I'll make sure it's pinned on well.
Good.
When I first saw the vessel, it looked like a very large, white lump sat on the side of the River Thames. And, you know, with the resources we've got, then it's as close as I can deliver to what I hope we're trying to achieve, really. You know, I think when all of the pieces come together on the Thursday before the performance, then I hope that it'll look even better than it does now, really. So when do you hope to set off with it?
Well, I'm hoping to leave probably in about a day and a half, 2 days' time. It's going down to Richmond. We're going to get it down to Richmond on the first day.
Stop and have a drink.
Stop by. Get my nerve back again and go the rest of the way.
While Ken prepares for the journey downriver, Andrew breaks the news to the musicians that playing on a boat isn't the only challenge they're going to face in their performance.
To make our life one step more difficult, we're going to read from handwritten parts which are being prepared right now by a scribe in an 18th century style, which means there could be human error in the parts, and we're going to have to use our musical instinct and our experience of playing Handel to get through those errors and not be put off by them. So, this is number 11. Okay. One, two, three. Although Handel kept his scores, the water music is lost, sadly. We only have some copies by other people of what the music was. We know there was music going one way up the river, Then they stopped for dinner, and there was probably music during dinner, and there was music going the other way. One source says that all the music was played at least three times. Now, all the music is an hour long, so maybe the musicians were playing for 3 hours. And it's been suggested, and I think it's a very good suggestion, that the trumpets and the horns were playing on the boat up and down the river, whereas the quieter music with flutes would have been played during dinner. The pieces we're going to be playing when we're on the boat are, if you like, the famous pieces, which for me epitomise the water music.
While London in 1717 was the centre of the commercial world, in matters of culture it lagged behind. But with the vogue for travel and the grand tour came an influx of people and ideas.
Venice brings together all our main players. It also was the great water city of the 18th century European world. Handel had spent most of 1706 to 1710 in Italy. He came to Italy as a kind of protege, developing composer. He left it as a fully fledged composer of opera. And many of his great works were written in Italy, and some of them, Agrippina, for example, was staged in Venice. Kilmansegg, George I's master of the horse, close advisor of him, came to Venice, met Handel here, was responsible for Handel going to Hanover and entering the service of George I. Now, George was always interested in Italy and interested in particular in Italian music. In fact, the Privy Purse receipts show that when he became king in Britain, he was a regular attender at the opera in London, went often to see the same opera performed again and again. Handel was an absolutely key figure in the popularity of Italian opera in London. And Italian opera was the cutting-edge, fashionable thing for the elite to be seen to be doing in the 17-teens and 1720s. London looked to Venice in many areas of the arts, not just in music. In architecture, there's the obvious instance of St. Paul's Cathedral, which looks very much like, in some respects, the Saluti Church here, which was finished in 1687. Politically, it was seen as anti-papal, it was seen as a vital and vibrant commercial and maritime society. There are a number of interesting paintings, for example, by Marlowe, which actually, they're called capriccios, and they actually mould and mix Venice and London. So that, for example, you see the city with St. Paul's Cathedral as if it was at the end of the Grand Canal. These paintings show the hold that Venice had on the imagination. And if you think about this hold, one starts to understand the potency of associations between London and Venice. We know from visitors to Italy about the Venetian practice of serenatas, musical entertainments on the water. These are both private and public. Private in that they were really for the people on the boats involved, and public because people at a greater distance and other boats or on the shore could see them. And that was characteristic of Venetian entertainments, certainly as reported by tourists. But on top of that, one had a more developed form of serenata, of evening musical entertainment, which had far more players and was much more dramatic, much grander. Giuseppe Baretti, writing for an English audience in his account of the manners and customs of Italy, wrote,
"At Venice, it is a thing really delightful to rove on a summer night about the laguna in a gondola and hear from several boats several bands of musicians playing and singing, the moon shining bright, the winds hushed, and the water smooth as glass."
I think that when they were considering how best to bolster George I in 1717, the echoes of the Venetian entertainments that had been seen were quite important. Venice set up resonances
cultural resonances, political resonances, which were fundamentally positive. And it made all the right noises about George I in terms of his political and cultural importance.
Because Handel can call on so many styles of music, he can one moment be very Italian and flamboyant, the next he can be rather more subtle and gentle in a French style, for example. He knew about French music, so he had all the ingredients there. Handel has really pulled out all the stops to produce this music, and if it was just an autumn, you know, a boat party, just one of many, he needn't have written such great music, but he's really done a special job for this. With just a day to go, Ken is towing the barge downriver to its starting position in Lambeth, where the finishing touches will be applied before restaging the water music premiere.
I tried to imagine this morning what it would be like as a waterman rowing that barge. Someone had phoned me up and said, you're on your way to Handel's water music. What would that have meant to me, you know? When you think my family's been on the river 500 years anyway, and it was very likely some of the predecessors would have been around. It would have been a nice thought to think that they were. It was obviously a summer's night, a nice flowing river. All you can hear is the paddles going in the water and coming out. And you get on this barge with this wonderful orchestra that is going to play that wonderful music. You can actually shut your eyes and feel that you're on any bit of the water anywhere in the world. And you can hear it ripple, and you can hear the moods of it. You must have been very proud when you were rowing this lovely, serene...